For our text this morning, I'd like to go to the first chapter of the wonderful book of Hebrews. Hebrews chapter 1. I want to read the first four verses. In the original text, the Greek text, this is one sentence. One sentence. Again, from Hebrews chapter 1, beginning with verse 1. God, who at various times and in various ways spoke in times past to the fathers by the prophets, has in these last days spoken to us by his Son, whom he has appointed heir of all things, through whom also he made the worlds, who being in the brightness of his glory and the express image of his person, and upholding all things by the word of his power, when he had by himself purged our sins, sat down at the right hand of the majesty on high, having become so much better than the angels, as he has by inheritance obtained a more excellent name than they. Neil Lightfoot, who was one of the great scholars of the Churches of Christ for the last half century, wrote a commentary on the book of Hebrews. It may be the very best or maybe the second best commentary that we have from American Churches of Christ. It's an excellent study. And as he began his exposition of this chapter one, he made this statement: "This is the most beautifully constructed and expressive sentence in the New Testament." Well, it is an amazing statement. Let me just say, as a sidelight here, that Brother Lightfoot has passed away during this year that we're ending very soon. And again, he was a great student. Anything that he has written, you would profit from reading. In recent days, of course, we have focused around the world on the humble birth of Jesus Christ, how he came to this earth and was born, of course, as you remember, in a stable, how he was placed as a little child, a baby, in a manger, which was basically a feed trough for animals, how his folks were really just traveling there and had to move on. And there are a lot of things that we make the point about in the last few days or last few weeks. But I want to go in another direction this morning and remind us again of another perspective all the way. This passage that we've chosen, Hebrews chapter 1, is truly a deep and profound passage in understanding the nature and the work of Jesus Christ. In fact, there are similar Christological passages in the New Testament. May I direct your attention for later study to John chapter 1, the first 15 verses, Colossians chapter 1, verses 15 through 20, or Philippians chapter 2, verses 5 through 11. These are, again, amazing, profound, soaring passages that challenge our thinking about Jesus Christ and what he really was and what he really is. But notice in the passage this simple expression: God spoke. God spoke. And the question is, did he? Did he really speak? And if he did not, then all else is worthless. We might as well close up this building and live a secular life and just do our own thing. But of course, we believe God did speak. We believe in the existence of a benevolent God, a caring God. And that caring God chose to communicate his will to us, to tell us about himself and about what he wants from us and how we can live a righteous and good life before him and before others. And so it's a monumental statement. God spoke. He revealed himself to us. He let us know what he was thinking, and especially about us. And what did he communicate in this passage? What did he speak about in this little section of Scripture. I would be the first to say it is so majestic. It is so profound. And I'm just simply scratching the surface. But I want you to think with me when the time we have this morning about it. But I'd like for you and challenge you to read it throughout this coming year and to think about this Christ that we honor and worship. Out front, we have the expression Church of Christ, because we want to honor him and place him in that pedestal and to say this church belongs to him and it must belong to him. He owns it. And for things that we will be talking about this morning, he is very precious and awesome for us. I have 8 things to say. I hope you have one of our outlines to follow along. They're in the foyer if you'd like to pick one up as we leave, if you don't have one now. There are 8, and I won't spend a lot of time with each one of them. And again, I couldn't really exhaust the meaning of any of these expressions. First of all, Jesus is God's final supreme revelation. In ages past, the point is made that God spoke various portions and ways by the prophets. And by the way, the word prophet is just another way of saying spokesman. Throughout time, the Lord presented his will through spokesmen, speaking for him, messengers, if you will, presenting his will to man. And it makes the point that the prophets spoke to the fathers. Well, that would be those of ancient times. And you can see here the Old Testament revelation. You know, of course, that our Bible is made up of 2 sections, the Old Testament and the New. Well, this is primarily talking about the Old Testament and the old revelation that comes to us in those 39 books that we have in the earlier part of the Bible. It makes the point that in the last days, God has spoken by his Son. In the last days is an expression that refers to our time. We're in the last period. We're in the last position as far as the sweep of time going through. And we are truly in the last days. It may be centuries, but it's still the last period. And this is, of course, the time when God has spoken through his Son. We have what we call progressive revelation. God, in the beginning, did not give all of his will. He didn't reveal all that he wanted mankind to know. But he, through time, as progressively given us more and more and more to the point that now we have the full revelation through Jesus Christ and his apostles and prophets. So we could say with this passage that revelation was given proportionally, in other words, a portion at this juncture, another portion here, another portion here, scattered through time. Then partially, not the full revelation, and then progressively it's been given as we've moved through century after century. But now, from this passage and many others, we can know that Jesus has given God's final supreme revelation. Number 2, Jesus, the writer of Hebrews says in verse 2, is God's Son. It says that God spoke to us in a Son. It's interesting that the writer does not say spoken to us by the Son, Jesus Christ. And what's the reason for that? There's some special reason why he would not say specifically the Son. Now that point is going to come out in a little bit. But the main reason for that is obvious. He is emphasizing the nature of Jesus Christ rather than the personality. In other words, the sonship means that he is of the same nature as the Father, just as I'm of the same nature of my physical Father, so Jesus Christ is the same nature as his Father. It's interesting in John chapter 5, I don't have that reference on our outline, but if you want to make a note of it, John chapter 5, verses 17 and 18. Has a passage where the Jews wanted to kill the Lord Jesus on the spot. And you know why? Because he was talking about God being his Father. And they understood, as Jesus would say that, that he was equating himself with his Father God. In other words, they were of the same nature, equal in that essence that they had and shared. And so they said, he's blaspheming. Let's kill him for that statement he's making. Now, of course, with that son, we are in the last period of time. We call it the Messianic period, the period of the Messiah, the period of the Christ. And we can live in his age, if you will. It's his special time. Thirdly, our Hebrew writer says Jesus is God's appointed heir. Again, verse 2. Notice he is the heir of all things. And if you think about it a moment, only if he is the only son can he be the heir of all things. I am an only child, or was an only child. When my parents passed away, I inherited everything. Why? Because I was the only child. Well, that's a simple illustration of what we're talking about here. The sharing, if you will, the connection, the link that Jesus Christ would have with God the Father. It's extremely important in understanding the relationship that these two have together. Now, of course, we can understand a lot of passages with this in mind. John chapter 16, verse 15. The Lord says, all things that the Father has are mine. So he links them together. He helps us understand the connection of the two. And here, obviously, you have the closest ties that you could imagine. Father and Son, heir of all things, coming together in that connection. Number four, we are told, again, same verse 2, Jesus is God's creative agent.